Sometimes it feels like you can walk for miles without noticing or being noticed by anything but the trees. There's always the chance of coming across the odd squirrel or deer or any of the other hairy little meatballs, but otherwise things can just seem empty. I think that empty feeling is just a matter of how you look at things. When you stay zoomed out, like so many of us do, you never really get a chance to see what's going on underneath the surface. When you get a little closer, you'll see that the forest is humming with tons of tiny, beautiful lives. Everything is covered with something green or crawly. Compared to the more charismatic, bigger organisms, I think the smallest things can be some of the most interesting and complex parts of the ecosystem. I'm rambling a little bit, but I guess what I'm saying is that there's a whole nother world that you can find in every little clump of grass or mossy rock, and all you have to do to be a part of it is look at things from a different angle. Just crouch down, zoom in, and enjoy the little things. So, it's time for me to take you on another little trip into the woods, which can be the best place to go in search of plants and fungi and other little things that seem kind of interesting. To get a better view of this hidden little world, I'm going to get on my knees, so get ready to whip out your nice, hard macro lens. A knee pad would be nice too, if you'd like. Alright, let's go. When you're looking for tiny things, moss is probably a good place to start off. Mosses are tiny plants that are evolutionarily ancient compared to the flowering vascular plants. They may not be super showy, but they look pretty neat when you get close. You can find them pretty much anywhere, on rocks and logs, by the water, on the roof of your house, and all over the place. This moss looks somewhat different from the other ones that I've seen. The new growth on it looks like little red rubies, something that I don't think I've seen before. When you change your perspective a bit, these tiny clumps of moss in the crack of a log form a miniature world. Some larger mosses do somewhat resemble vascular plants, and have an almost juniper-like appearance. On this moss, you can see the very simple leaves that are almost more like scales. These round little capsules are the moss's sporophytes. These will eventually open and release spores, letting the moss reproduce. If they don't get eaten by slugs first, that is. Up close, there's a glistening film that's webbing between the sporophytes. It's a slime trail left behind by the slugs, and it's a strange mucus consisting of sluggy carbohydrates and hygroscopic proteins. Pretty, but a little bit gross. Moving on, this is some sphagnum moss. I'm not sure on the species, since sphagnum is a pretty diverse genus, with waters that can be difficult to navigate. These cushy mosses play a surprisingly important role in the environment. Sphagnum is found growing on nice round bumps and mounds. The plants grow from the green tips up and out. As they grow, the older plant material tends to accumulate underneath, due to phenolic compounds that help resist decay. Eventually, on a timescale beyond your lifetime, this little moss might store huge amounts of carbon in the form of a peat deposit. When growing in the understory like this, sphagnum can slowly accumulate and change the soil chemistry, forming a dense, acidified mat. This ultimately can change the forest composition, selecting for tree species that can live with the conditions under a sphagnum carpet. This larch forest doesn't seem to mind too much, although sphagnum is a very minor component in the understory here. Out in the open of a sphagnum bog, where dead moss makes up the growing media entirely, you might find a severely limited selection of plants, including these carnivorous sarracenia and sundews, and although we're out of season now, cranberries. Mosses can also facilitate the growth of other plants. When a tree dies, the moss on its bark can continue to grow. A nice, light, moisture-retentive layer of moss can serve as a perfect seedbed. The fallen tree begins to decay with the help of fungi that, quite happily, poke their spore-bearing mushrooms through the moss. After several seasons, seeds can sprout on top of the moss layer, and the seedlings work their way through the soft, wet, decomposing wood. The wood and moss are eventually returned to the soil, and a new tree is in place to repeat the cycle again. Similar things can happen on rocks, although the weathering and formation of soil takes a much longer time. In this case, mosses have anchored themselves to a rock. Instead of roots, mosses have rhizoids, which are similar in appearance but different in function. Rhizoids don't have the same ability to uptake nutrients in the way that vascular plants' roots can. After who knows how many years, enough moss has accumulated to allow other plants to grow. Now, a partridge berry plant is rooted in the moss that holds just enough moisture for other life. You might notice that where there's moss, there's often lichen too. Some might confuse mosses and lichens for one another, since they both tend to grow in the same places and look generally greenish. While mosses are true plants, lichens are the result of a symbiotic relationship between algae or cyanobacteria and fungi. The fungal component creates a sort of housing for the algae to safely photosynthesize. Think of it sort of like inviting your friend over to live with you, but on the one condition that they continue to make you dinner for the rest of your lives. Some of these lichen are really cool looking up close. It almost makes you feel like you're under the sea in a coral reef or something. They have such a nice color, like oxidized copper or ancient bronze. Mix together some moss, lichen, and a few turkey tail mushrooms with a soft lens, and you're in a new alien landscape. I don't think I've talked much about turkey tail, but they're an interesting medicinal mushroom that's used for immune system support, among other things. I'll try to dedicate some more time to them on a later date. When you're looking at mosses and lichens and whatever other little things you can find on logs, you might come across some sneaky little things, like this. At first glance, this little patch of mottled fuzz could easily be a glop of mint chocolate chip ice cream, and that's the perfect color for blending in with moss and lichen, so I'm surprised I even found it. It's interesting how the patterns on this moth mimic the colors and folds of lichen. Had it been somewhere on lichen instead of somewhere brown, it would have been nearly undetectable. Luckily, it's cool out, so he's too lazy to creep away before getting some glamour shots. So, I had Pikmin on the GameCube, and that's made me a little cautious of bugs that blend in with their surroundings. Normally, that's asking for an ambush attack, but I think this one's friendly enough. If you take a step up and move on from mosses and lichens, you enter the vast forests of Equisetum, commonly known as horsetail. These plants, or their now fossilized ancestors, once dominated the forests of the Paleozoic era. Now, they're really only forests if you're a little bug, or a newt maybe. Either way, with a little imagination and your head stuck in the ground, they can still be sprawling forests of coniferous trees or bamboo, just a little smaller. Horsetails have really interesting strobili, or in the singular, strobilus. This is the spore-bearing structure that resembles a honeycombed pine cone. Moving on to bugs, there are plenty of tiny things crawling around in the woods, and they can be pretty goofy to watch. If you want to see some life that's buzzing and humming, one of your best bets is to start looking for some flowers. That's kind of a no-brainer, since a lot of flowers attract insects for pollination. We're going to start with this nice patch of oxeye daisies. These flowers are not native to the northeastern United States, but have naturalized here after being introduced from Europe. You could probably find these just about anywhere at this point, either on the edge of forests or on unmowed strips of grass at a gas station. I think you'd be surprised at the variety of life you could find just on some daisies. Here, a crab spider lies in wait, blending in quite nicely with the white petals. It's probably waiting for some unsuspecting pollinator to come by. Where pollinators might come, traps will be sprung. I think I might have spooked him a bit, though. Luckily, this damselfly chose a safe daisy to rest on. I wonder who would have won, though. Here's another symbiotic relationship, taking place between ants and aphids. For those of you that don't know, the aphids are the little green round bugs attached to the daisy stem, and I'm sure you can tell which ones the ants are. Aphids feed by piercing the plant's phloem with a little stylet, and then passively uptake the plant's juice. Since the phloem is under pressure, they don't need to actively work much for their food. It pretty much just squirts right into them. Aphids then excrete a sugary goop called honeydew. That's where the ants come in. These ants tend to the aphids like shepherds, that is, if shepherds drank directly from the animals. They milk the aphids by stroking their antennae and feed off of the honeydew that they excrete. This has given them the name dairying ants. In return for the sugary goop, the ants protect the aphids from predators and keep them safe, much like shepherds and their sheep. Instead of scaring wolves away, they're more likely to fend off wasps and other aphid predators. If you see ants dutifully patrolling a plant, take a closer look, since this same interaction occurs on countless plants that the different aphid species feed on. This young aspen shoot is another good pasture for aphids. Same milk, different cow. Is that an expression? Probably not, but I think it fits. Tiny stuff. It's all over the place if you look for it. And if you don't look, you might miss out on things like whatever this little beetle is. And it's not always easy to get things in focus when they're tiny. I'm dealing with some cheap manual lenses, so if the bugs are quick, I'm essentially dicked. It's much easier to look at things like this golden tortoise beetle. Not too exciting, I'll admit, but it's shiny and it doesn't run very fast. Or at least it isn't at the moment. In the spirit of tiny things, let's look at some more petite wildflowers. Here's one that you probably wouldn't notice without looking for it. This is the white avens, Geum canadense. It's a pretty nondescript wildflower, and to be honest, it's a bit underwhelming to look at from a distance. Taking a closer look at the flower, they're kind of pretty and extremely delicate. To me, they resemble the flowers of a blackberry, or a strawberry, or any of the other various related plants in the Rosaceae family. These flowers have five fragile white petals, which aren't present for too long, and behind the petals are pointed sepals that are pretty large. There are countless stamens and styles in the center of the flower. These develop into a round ball of hooked seeds that resemble burrs. The mature seeds can then catch on animals or clothing to be transported elsewhere. The plants themselves are pretty small and delicate, topping off at around 3 feet, but they're oftentimes a little bit smaller. The leaves at the base are compound. I'm not sure if this is really all that useful of a plant. There are related species that can be used, but not much is out there regarding the white avens. There are some reports that the roots can be made into a sort of chocolate flavoring, which would be big if true. From what I've tasted of the fresh roots, there is definitely an interesting aromatic component, but it's a little bit more spicy or fruity. It's kind of like a pinch of clove or something. That's definitely something I'd want to take a more in-depth look at later. Now, I don't know about chocolate, but this plant growing nearby definitely smells off when you crush a leaf. It smells like geraniums, or for those of you who haven't experienced that, it's like a mild burnt tire kind of smell. It's a surprising smell for such a dainty pink flower. This flower is known as Herb Robert, or Geranium robertianum. It was named after some guy Robert, who was an herbalist, monk, and Christian saint and all of that. Anyways, these flowers are pretty, tiny, and pink. They have five petals, and as you can see on this one, there's five female bits poking out as well. The mature seed heads are said to resemble stork's bills, hence the other common name, stork's bill. The leaves are palmately divided and quite feathery. They take on a fern-like appearance, and can resemble members of the carrot family. It also helps to take notice of the hairy stems and nodes on the lower part of the plant. Apparently, Herb Robert is used in herbal medicine for various liver problems, If you're going to use these medicinally, just make sure to do some research first. I realize that I haven't really dove into tiny mushrooms yet, and there are all sorts of those, so let's take a look at a couple fun ones. This is a type of tiny mushroom, which I think is rhizomarasmius pyrrhocephalus, but I wouldn't put too much money on that. There's another species that looks quite similar, and it could just as easily be. Tiny mushrooms like this can be really difficult to identify without taking things to a microscopic level, which I'm not really outfitted for. So in that case, we'll have to take note of every little detail that there is. What we can see, obviously, is an orangey cap, with white gills, maybe producing a white spore print. Upon really close inspection, the gills are not attached to the stem. There's just a pinch of a gap. The tough, blackening stem with the very small hairs is another feature that can help distinguish this mushroom. I uprooted one of them, and it shows some really hairy mycelium at the base. That's the good stuff that's working its way through all the old oak leaves on the forest floor. It is kind of crazy that these can even poke through the dense layer of leaves on the forest floor, although I wouldn't be surprised if they have to wind and twist a bit, following the traces of light before breaking free. A tiny little umbrella and the sea of leaves. So that's about all I've got with this little mushroom. These next mushrooms, believe it or not, are a type of chanterelle, despite topping off at around an inch tall. They have a nice golden yellow color and the characteristic false gills that are just barely seen as raised ridges underneath the cap. These mushrooms are Cantharellus minor, and they're pretty much exactly what they seem like, just really, really, really small chanterelles. They almost look the same as the standard golden chanterelles, but they're lacking all of the heft. They even form the same mycorrhizal association with trees. I wonder if they're more efficient symbionts than the other mushrooms, only producing these tiny little fruits and not stealing too much energy from the tree. The small chanterelles are edible, but it would take hundreds of these to just make one regular size chanterelle. I don't know how much time you're willing to spare, but that's almost certainly not worth it for me. Alright, what else do I have left to show you? Here's a grub and a monkey flower, if you're into that kind of thing. But other than that, I think I'm just about done. I don't really know where I was going with all this, but I hope you enjoyed the ride. Just remember that there are tons of tiny little things out there, just waiting to be found. Or hiding, more likely, but you can still find them. I believe in you. I haven't even scratched the surface of all the little bugs and flowers and fungi, but hopefully we'll have a chance to look at some more another time soon. I'm really hoping to ramp things up a little bit this year, after things warm up and the snow is replaced with green, but we'll see how that works out. Thanks for watching, and take care of yourselves. Bye.